so much for your kind words. Before I start, I must place on record my deep appreciation to the entire team led by Dr. Narahari Shastri, who have done such a phenomenal job of putting things together in such a short notice for conducting the Summer Research Training Program 2020. As was correctly pointed out, we are living in a very challenging times, and the real human spirit of innovation comes out in such challenging times. Narahari Shastri very correctly pointed it out that most of our innovations and creativity really comes to the fore in times such as this. I would like to compliment the entire team, Dr. Narahari Shastri, Dr. Ranjan Agarwal, Dr. Alok Dhawan, Dr. Mudkavi, Shri Chakravarti, and everyone else who is involved in these efforts of attracting as many as 16,000 applications is phenomenal in such a short notice. That also is a reflection of the fact that how vibrant is our new generation. So younger generation of scientists who are actually hungry for knowledge, and despite the fact that the country is going through a lockdown, the country is going through an extraordinarily challenging time, all the people have risen and shown that they are indeed hungry for the knowledge. So I welcome all of you to this particular program. And let us see, in next about half an hour, I would like to try to present to you three different aspects. One aspect is how creative our population has been in our geographical area over centuries. The second aspect is post-independence, how CSIR emerged as a leading S&T organization of the country, and how it has led country on the path of development on all fronts. And the third aspect is what CSIR is doing even today in the challenging times. So these are the three things that I would like to put forth before you for consideration. My PowerPoint slides are available as PDF, and Dr. Narahari Shastri would actually be happy to make this available to anyone of you who would like to have a look at them. What I would like to actually start from ancient times, and for the fact that many of us have been taught in our history that science and technology was kind of non-existent in our country until the foreign powers arrived here. And we were actually told that all the developments of the modern development that what we talk of essentially happened because of the arrival of some of the foreign powers in our country. And that is a wrong notion. That part of history needs to be corrected. What we actually should be proud that human beings, in whichever environment they live in, they are always very curious, and in whichever corner of the world they live, they are always very innovative, and we are no exception. The people who have lived in our geography have been no exception in their innovations, in their probing of the nature, and asking the questions and making sure that society benefits by the innovations that they have had in their mind. The very fact that we have had a very long tradition of settlements in our continent actually reflects that particular fact. The people living in this continent have been extraordinarily innovative. And I want to just give you two or three different examples before I come to the post-independent development. The first of the examples is this. And in fact, only 2 days ago, there's a paper which came in Science, a journal called Science, which showed that as early as 48,000 years ago, there is an evidence of people using bows and arrows in Sri Lanka. And similar evidences, also archaeological evidences, exist in India that people have been actually using tools for their own purpose, for their own living, even as long ago as about 50,000 years ago. Now, this is a brilliant example of this particular statue. This is about 5,000 years ago from the Harappan civilization, what we call. And it shows that even 5,000 years ago, people knew how to blend metals. People knew how to cast metals. And they knew how to use something called a loss wax technology, which is used even today to make statues of metals and this and that. So actually it's a brilliant fact, brilliant example that even 5,000 years ago, people had actually found out a loss wax technology and blending and casting of metal. It's a fantastic example that how people have been very innovative in their own manifestation of their own thoughts and other aspects. In terms of society, how it benefits society directly, is another brilliant example of innovation. Now, this innovation has existed since about 7th century AD. And if you go across India in the hilly regions, in the foothills of Himalayas, you start from Jammu and Kashmir, Himachal Pradesh, Uttarakhand, Uttar Pradesh, Sikkim, and the Northeast. Across the entire belt of the foothills of Himalayas, you find presence of something called a gharat. What's a gharat? Those of you who have had chance to go to these regions, you will see that wherever there are water streams coming down the mountains, these water streams have been used as flour mills. So from 7th century AD, we actually have designed very sophisticated gear system by which a flour mill can be generated. A wheel on the top rotates, you put wheat into that and out comes wheat flour. You know, it's fantastic. This is much before electricity operated flour mills have been generated. And in the rest of the country, people actually used to do it by hand. And those of you remember your grandmothers and all, many people had it at home where wheat flour used to be made by grinding manually at home, but not in the foothills of Himalayas. There, the energy from the water which was flowing down was used in the gharats, and it's a fantastic example. 7th century AD, you know, it's about 1300 years ago, this technology was developed by our own people in our own geography. Now the question comes, how does the state support science and technology and such kind of innovations? Whosoever is in power, whether it's a king or an emperor or a democracy, the job of the state is essentially to promote such kind of innovations and support science and technology led development. And what do people do? People do very simple things. They implement the policies suggested by scientists and technologists. And let me give you one example from 1st century AD. This is an example from 1st century AD, roughly about 2000 years ago. The Chola kings then in the southern part of India generated this dam on the Kaveri River. And today, if you go there near Trichy, it's called Kallanai Dam, is still in use. And in fact, it so happens, there's the oldest dam in the history that is still in use today across the world. Around the world is the oldest dam still in use, made in 1st century AD. And the dam had major purpose of providing irrigation to the farmers. And that's exactly where the state steps in. The Chola kings actually recognize the fact that farming is an essential activity, and to provide irrigation to the farmers is actually an important aspect. And therefore, the Chola kings drafted in the technologies of that generation to make this kind of dam. It's absolutely marvelous example of a dam that was made. And as all of us know, that agriculture was a very thriving activity even then in our country. In fact, if you look at India's history, there are many, many such examples that we can go on giving. For example, in mathematics, in astronomy, in metallurgy, and also in medicines. We can talk of many different things. Today in the corona times, we are talking of vaccines. And many of us know that vaccines have existed in India as a practice which was followed from 12th century AD, what is called as the Tika practice. It was followed by the learned people of Banaras who would traverse across the country and vaccinate people just ahead of the monsoon. You know, this practice has been very prevalent. So if you are told that vaccination came because of the knowledge that Europeans brought here, I think it's not fully correct. Probably it was right that Edward Jenner for the first time showed from the modern science perspective how vaccination actually happens or how vaccination should be done. But the practice existed even before that as the Tika practice. So we should be very proud that the people living in this era have been very innovative and had adopted science and technology as an essential component of the development of human beings. We should be proud of another fact that when we became independent in 1947, our forefathers clearly saw science and technology as the major driver of development. And ours is a very unique constitution, and we must thank our forefathers and the people who wrote our constitution that they hardwired in our contribution, in our constitution. H is what you see of Article 51A, which says to develop the scientific temper, humanism, and a spirit of inquiry and reform. This is hardwired in our constitution. And we should be very, very proud of our people who wrote our constitution to make sure that science and technology and spirit of inquiry is a part of our national constitution. I would like to give you the examples of modern India. What were the challenges when the British left us? I would just like to highlight a fact that when the British arrived here in the form of East India Company, somewhere in the mid 18th century. At that time, the country was a very, very prosperous country. Many of us know that the total GDP that we contributed to the world was of the order of about 27% of world GDP was contributed by India at that time. When the British left us in 1947, our contribution had dropped down to about 2%, because essentially all the industry, all the manufacturing had moved out of India, and therefore our contribution was very low. And in fact, we were left as a very poor nation, deprived of almost everything that we could think of. So the major challenge for the people of the generation that went by, the major challenge behind before them was how do we resurrect our country using science and technology as the major driver. And therefore, we can actually look at rough period starting from 1950s. There was a period of self-reliance. Then came the period of 70s to 1990s of technology denial era, in which every possible technology around the world was denied to India because the world was scared that India would become a superpower one day using these technologies. But that's not to be. We want to be a superpower as far as science and technology is concerned, but we are an extremely peaceful nation, as our history tells us, for the last 5,000 years. We don't have geographical ambitions, and we have very peace-loving ideas that have emerged from our country. People like Gautam Buddha and people like Mahatma Gandhi were born and were the epistles of peace around the world of their own era. The eras of 1990s to about 2000 was an era in which we became aware of intellectual property, and I'll comment about a little bit about it later. And now today is an era in which we have globalized ourselves, and we have to see how we become Atmanirbhar, as the Honorable Prime Minister has said. In today's era, how do we actually move forward with Atmanirbharta? And CSIR has in its genes the Atmanirbharta always built in from its beginning. As I said, when we began our journey in 1947, one of the first challenges ahead of us was how are we going to implement the democracy in our country. We had adopted democracy as a form of governance, and democracy's essential principle is that how do we ensure that every citizen gets a right to exercise his or her vote. And CSIR came up with a very, very innovative solution. What you see on the forefinger of the Honorable Prime Minister here is an ink that was developed by CSIR Laboratory, National Physical Laboratory, and then the technology was transferred to Mysore Ink, and this ink is now used in many countries around the world, including in India. You know, every time you go and vote in the elections, please remember that the ink was developed by CSIR Laboratory in 1950s in order to implement democracy. And those who would like to have an even better example, a better known example to all of you, is someone here. Look at this. Even the celebrities actually show what CSIR has done in implementing the democracy in the country. There are a whole lot of other challenges that we are facing, and CSIR contributed very, very richly to each of these. During the Green Revolution, one of the challenges was how are we going to mechanize the revolution, mechanize the agriculture. And CSIR took upon itself the part of mechanization of agriculture and produced the first tractor in the country. You know, the tractors were not available then, and agriculture was essentially practiced through bullock carts and through manual means. But CSIR took upon the challenge of mechanizing everything, and what we see result is that many agri-pesticides were developed by our laboratories then to implement Green Revolution and see its benefits for common people. But then CSIR also did many other wonderful things. The entire emergence of pharmaceutical industry in the country, especially the generic pharma in 1970s and 1980s, is CSIR's direct role in the development of nation. Some of you may remember in 1980s, probably the era before many of you were born, there were another very dreaded disease was sweeping across the planet, called a human immune deficiency virus, or HIV, which causes the disease AIDS, or acquired immunodeficiency syndrome. And the real fear was that it is going to sweep across the planet and going to affect a large population. A number of companies devised drugs against it, essentially from the West. However, these drugs were extraordinarily costly and had to be made available at an affordable price to countries like India. And CSIR took upon itself to make these drugs affordable and transfer the technologies to a number of countries. And companies such as Cipla then started producing these drugs and supply to the entire African subcontinent. And that's how actually drugs became very, very affordable in the 1980s. When somebody filed a patent on haldi in United States, CSIR took upon itself to go and fight that patent. You know, haldi is a traditional knowledge of India. For generations, people have used haldi. Some of you might remember when you have running nose or if you have sour throat, your mother or your grandmother gives you hot milk mixed with haldi and jaggery. This is a very common remedy in India. And haldi is known to have protective properties on many of such kind of disorders. This is known, but someone in US filed a patent on it. And what it would mean? Therefore, using haldi for any medicinal properties, we would pay some money as royalty to that particular company. But CSIR, recognizing this fact, filed a suit in United States and very successfully fought a patent, and the patent was eventually revoked. That's one of the greatest contributions of CSIR in modern era. Similarly, creation of jobs from leather industry has also been fantastic and fascinating story that we can talk some other day. More recently, CSIR has been working very close to the farmers. This is one of the rice varieties that CSIR has developed. The Center for Cellular and Molecular Biology in Hyderabad, in collaboration with some of the ICAR institutes and with support from DBT and CSIR, has developed a variety of Sambar Masuri. What you can see on the right hand side, the rice which is not Sambar Masuri, which is blight resistant, you can see the yellow top on that, that is affected by the blight. While in the front towards us, what you see is the green rice, that is actually resistant rice, and that has been developed by CSIR. And on today's date, about 2 lakh hectare land is under cultivation for this particular rice in 7 different states of India. We expect that about 10 to 20 lakh hectare will come under cultivation in the coming few years. Another great example I want to actually tell you very quickly is a very recent example, only 1 year old example. That is in the alcohol industry, which uses sugarcane as one of the major form as a distillery to generate ethanol. On the right hand side at the bottom, you see what comes out as an effluent is what we call as spent wash. Now, ethanol industry is a very thriving industry in the country. About 50 million people and families in India are dependent on it. About 5 million hectares is under cultivation for the sugarcane in the country. And about 80,000 crore is the annual turnover of this particular one. But the spent wash is extraordinarily polluting. You cannot discharge it into water. You cannot discharge in ground. And our lab in Bhavnagar, that the Central Salt and Marine Chemical Research Institute, or CSMCRI, came up with this particular solution. They took spent wash, extracted organics out of it, what you see on the left, and the organics can now be used as animal feed. Then as you move towards right, the inorganics are now extracted in terms of potassium nitrate. And all of you know that potassium nitrate is a very good fertilizer. And therefore, we can actually extract two aspects out of spent wash. One is the organics that go as cattle feed, and the inorganics, which are potassium and all, which can be used as fertilizers in agriculture. What remains is pure water that can be used back once again. So what it has actually enabled us is that it has created about 15,000 new jobs by using this technology, and it is environmentally friendly, and the water can now be circulated. So it's a perfect example of what we call today as circular economy. And it's a very recent example, as I said, what CSIR has been contributing very significantly to our society. The other example that I want to give you before I hang up is that of our successful aroma mission. And I would encourage you to go to this particular video to show how farmers across the country have been benefited by the aroma mission of CSIR in recent times. Much of the land that this farming has been done is non-cultivable land. The land cannot be actually used for cultivating other crops, but aroma crops can actually be grown there very easily. And our laboratories have actually gone and helped the farmers to generate aromatic plants there. But not only that, they have also installed distillation units there so that the farmer can get economic value out of it. And on Twitter, this particular link that I have shown you here shows you how it has brought benefit to large amount of farmers, large number of farmers in the state of Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir. Is a fantastic example that how CSIR has brought so much value to the farmers through our aroma mission. The last example that I want to talk to you about is the coronavirus. All of us recognize that we are passing through an extraordinary situation. It is unbelievable that 6 months ago, we could have imagined that we cannot get out of our house easily. We cannot imagine that you have to work from home. We cannot imagine that college and school examinations were postponed. We cannot imagine that so many people have been locked inside their houses. It was impossible to imagine 6 months ago, but in the world changed at a stroke as we were entering the new year. A cluster of people in China was seen to have symptoms which are like pneumonia, and it was ascribed to a new virus that emerged, what is called as the severe acute respiratory syndrome, coronavirus 2 or SARS-CoV-2, which causes this particular disease that is now sweeping across the planet at this moment. There's a new challenge for scientists and technologists around the world. What would people do in India? CSIR recognized that this is going to be a global pandemic in early March. Just as about WHO was in the process of declaring this as a global pandemic, CSIR team, the entire CSIR team came together and devised a strategy of coronavirus mitigation. And I'm very proud that all the CSIR labs have risen to the occasion of this mitigation process of coronavirus. The country, we did not make any PPEs in the countries before the coronavirus came here. CSIR rose to the occasion and started making PPEs. On today's date, the technology that we have given to a company in Bangalore makes about 30,000 PPEs per day. The country was extremely short of ventilators. On today, that's not going to be the case. Our lab in Bangalore, the National Aerospace Laboratory, has made a prototypic ventilator, and many companies have come forward to commercialize this. Very soon, that is in another 15 days, you will see the ventilators made by CSIR in the market. Oxygen is premium. People who undergo the severe symptoms of the disease find themselves that they're short of oxygen. Our laboratory in Pune, the National Chemical Laboratory, has made an oxygen enrichment unit. Hospitals are going to be in short. In fact, isolation wards are going to be in short. Our two laboratories, the Central Building Research Institute in Roorkee and a Structural Engineering Research Center in Chennai, both of them have come forward with solutions. They can go and very quickly make 1,000-bedded hospitals in any city in a matter of only a few days. It's amazing. The diagnostics today is only based on RT-PCR, and 15 of our labs are actively engaged, including the IITR, which is led by Dr. Alok Dhawan here, and NIST Jorhat, which is led by Dr. Narari Shastri here. Both these labs, along with 13 other labs of CSIR, are involved actively in the diagnostics. But a diagnostic test today is what we call as the RT-PCR, but CSIR has come forward with new methods of diagnosis, more accurate, more quicker, and more affordable. All these tests are actually very accurate, quick, and they're affordable. And these tests would be in the field very soon now. CSIR got a large number of candidates in clinical trials, whether be it MW, whether be it certain drugs like favipiravir, or whether be in certain other formulations, plant derived formulations or Ayush formulations. CSIR was very quick in initiating clinical trials in collaboration with some of the major companies in the country. And last but not the least, when the world was saying that hydroxychloroquine is not very effective in coronavirus mitigation, there's a paper which was published in the journal Lancet, a very, very prestigious journal. From the people, from the professors in Harvard University, CSIR took upon itself to show that this paper was faulty, and the pressure that was built upon Lancet, in which CSIR participated, it was a global pressure that was built upon Lancet, eventually paper had to be withdrawn. As all of you know, one of the major producers of hydroxychloroquine is India. And if this paper had withstood the scrutiny of all the scientific community, probably hydroxychloroquine would not have been used in coronavirus mitigation. We are hopeful that hydroxychloroquine is a very good prophylactic drug, and we are hopeful that the world will recognize that as prophylaxis, the drug could be used against coronavirus. And therefore, India could once again play a very critical role in the mitigation of coronavirus. That's not actually what we are doing. And perhaps during the next course of next few weeks, if the summer training is really going on well and if enthusiasm remains, we can come back and talk issues related to coronavirus and what CSIR has done. And many of our scientists in the CSIR system would be very delighted to tell you about what CSIR has done. Now, that's all that actually I had to say. Before I hang up, I would just like to leave you with this particular thought. These are the seven deadly sins that Mahatma Gandhi had proposed to us. And look at the sin number 5. It says that one should never practice science without humanity. Those of us who want to be scientists or technologists or engineers in future, we must inculcate in our mind that human face is the front face of science, and therefore when we practice science, we must be humans first and make sure that we have empathy for other human beings as much as what we have for everyone else. Thank you all very much for your kind attention. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir. Actually, there are so many questions, and actually one person called Shweta who asked how exactly should we answer the questions as we are all muted. So Ms. Shweta,